Godzilla versus King Kong.
Let them fight.
All that's missing now is if we put them both into a Hell in a Cell cage match, throw in a couple of steel chairs, and 12-year-old me would go crazy and sell all my Pokemon cards just to get the pay-per-view for the ultimate, ultra, super, mega, heavyweight championship match of my childhood dreams. Godzilla, the OG kaiju, or the OK if you will, an icon of Japanese culture and known the world over for his gargantuan size, his radioactively bad breath, and who could forget that spine-chilling roar. But who is he really? And how has the currently reigning King of the Monsters evolved from his first appearance back in 1954? In this video, we're going to go 88 miles per hour and take a look at Godzilla's beginnings as an analogy for the horrors of nuclear war, all the way up to his 2021 matchup against the Empire State Building's archenemy, King Kong. Godzilla's origins start in 1950s Japan, in a country still reeling from the effects of two atomic bombs in the decade prior. Tomoyuki Tanaka, a film producer for Toho Studios, had an idea of creating a monster movie that both admonishes the use of nuclear weapons and showcases the resilience of Japan's people against such destructive power. He envisioned the creature as a prehistoric reptile, having laid dormant at the bottom of the ocean for a millennia, but suddenly awakened and drastically enhanced by an American hydrogen bomb test. Once disturbed from its deep sleep, it comes to loom large over the Tokyo skyline, with a head shaped like a mushroom cloud and scaly, irritated skin. And so, Gojira was born. In 1954, Toho opened Gojira to massive box office success, making over 17 times its budget, but it also proved successful in the West, prompting a 1956 re-release for American audiences, where the film was retitled as Godzilla, King of the Monsters, where the name Godzilla is first used. Godzilla skyrockets to the international stage, becoming a household name. His popularity spawns a number of sequels, introducing even more of the kaiju we all know and love to the franchise. And you'll be surprised to learn that the first kaiju to be featured after Godzilla isn't actually Mothra or even Ghidorah, but none other than King Kong himself. In 1962, Godzilla vs. Kong debuted, pitting the two titans against each other for the first time. Fans of the series hailed the film as an instant classic, and this Godzilla-Kong duel is considered one of the best kaiju versus films ever made. Well, for now. Riding high on its atomic breath of success, the Godzilla franchise goes on to add even more titans to its kaiju roster, while Godzilla himself gradually switches teams to the good guys, slowly becoming the anti-hero of the franchise after teaming up with Mothra and Rodan in a battle for Earth with King Ghidorah in 1964's Ghidorah, the three-headed monster. After a 9-year hiatus, 1984 starts off a new arc for the Godzilla franchise, the Heisei era. Here, Toho completely revamps Godzilla's story, retconning all events after the original 1954 film and starting anew with a redesigned Godzilla in 1975's Return of Godzilla, now even more towering at a height of 80 meters versus the Showa era Godzilla's 50, in order to look even larger against Tokyo's now skyscraper-filled skyline. In this film, Godzilla returns from a commercialized, kid-friendly image to his darker roots as a symbol for the consequences of war and nuclear disaster, this time with a dash of American and Soviet Cold War tension. This era also goes deeper scientifically and sheds light on the nature of Godzilla's biology, introducing Biollante in 1989's Godzilla vs. Biollante, a rose kaiju hybrid created with Godzilla's DNA spliced with that of a rose. Though relatively brief, the Heisei era brings back a few of the more popular kaiju from the Showa era, even giving Mothra her own standalone trilogy. Alas, yet again, declining box office performance and interest in the series, even amongst the original creators of the first film, forces Toho to put Godzilla out of his misery in 1995's Godzilla vs. Destroya, succeeding him with another one of his sons and, I assume, aspiring rapper, Little Godzilla. This would also be the last film that Tomoyuki Tanaka would have a hand in producing, and so, with his departure and Godzilla's demise, the Heisei era comes to a close. Sorry, Lil Zilla. Godzilla, produced by Sony subsidiary TriStar Pictures, the first exclusively American-produced Godzilla film. 1998's Godzilla opened to highly negative reception and backlash over its highly unfaithful T-Rex depiction of Godzilla, and how its strong similarity to the 1990s blockbuster Jurassic Park series made it seem like a shameless cash grab off the Universal Picture franchise's coattails. And with that, TriStar's plans for two future sequels got cancelled, and thank Godzilla! The turn of the century Millennium series is notable for abandoning a single continuity for the series, and is largely made up of separate standalone films. The most notable of the bunch is 2004's Godzilla Final Wars, where Toho goes on an all-out monster mash to celebrate Godzilla's long history, even bringing back Godzilla's son, Manila. Unfortunately, even this grand finale couldn't shake Godzilla's true rival. Poor box office returns. Toho then announces that it would abstain from making any more Godzilla movies for 10 years, and once more, Godzilla returns to, you guessed it, another deep ocean slumber until his next comeback in 2014. Monsterverse and Ewa era. And what a comeback it is! In 2010, Legendary Pictures acquired Godzilla's licensing rights and announced a partnership with the Warner Brothers to produce the Monsterverse, starting with 2014's Godzilla. This film reboots the Godzilla story and integrates it with the future Monsterverse, and also features the biggest Godzilla seen at the time of its release at a whopping 108 meters. In this contemporary iteration, Godzilla faces off with the Legendary's own homegrown kaiju, the massive unidentified terrestrial organisms, or MUTOs for short. Awakened by classic Cold War hijinks in 1954, Godzilla's existence and the world government's futile attempts at eliminating him is kept secret under the guise of atomic tests. In the present day, two MUTOs awaken to initiate a mating ritual, but Godzilla, probably not liking being the third wheel, stops the MUTOs in a fiery battle in San Francisco, where we are treated to an epic scene of his atomic breath in action. The film was released to huge box office success, with critics praising its visual effects and this time faithful depiction of Godzilla, while its common criticisms include Godzilla's relative lack of screen time and its lopsided focus on underdeveloped characters. Nevertheless, its success encouraged Legendary Pictures and Warner Brothers to continue development of the MonsterVerse with their next release, Kong Skull Island, in 2018, as well as 2019's Godzilla sequel, Godzilla King of the Monsters, which brought back Mothra, Rodan, and King Ghidorah in a visually stunning global Royal Rumble, ending in Godzilla claiming his crown as King of the Monsters. But can he keep it? We'll soon find out in the next MonsterVerse installment, the sure-to-be iconic monster brawl that is Godzilla vs. Kong, where we'll find out if Kong has what it takes to put the KO on the OK. Back in Japan, the Dewa era debuts with Shin Godzilla in 2016, marking a significant return to the series' roots by using Godzilla as a depiction of Japanese struggle, and also takes a darker tone and reframes Godzilla back into an antagonist role, using him as an analogy for the 21 Fukushima nuclear disaster, and the film itself as a social commentary over the Japanese government's response to said event, and they even brought back the guy in the suit. Well, it's a motion capture suit, but that still counts. Godzilla's depiction here might be his most sinister and creepiest look ever. While he starts out as an eel-like creature with bulging bug-like eyes, slithering his way through Tokyo's streets and conjuring images of the tsunami that preceded the 2011 incident, he then morphs into his more familiar form, although that may be overselling it. This new Godzilla is almost jet black in color, with more jagged rock-like looking skin and dorsal fins that resemble molten lava. His lack of lips, more numerous extra sharp fangs, and small black pupils lean more toward his creepy aesthetic. He can also unhinge his jaw in two and unleash a fury of flame from his belly, as well as fire purple lasers out of his dorsal fins. His tail is much longer relative to his body versus previous incarnations of the kaiju, and also has a face at the end of it. If Clive Barker ever directed a Godzilla movie, his Godzilla would probably look like this. Shin Godzilla brought moderate earnings at the box office and was largely positively received. It was then followed by an anime film trilogy which shows Godzilla at his largest on-screen incarnation yet, Godzilla Earth, at an absolutely massive 318 meters, in addition to three novels to accompany the series, as well as plans for another animated series releasing on Netflix in April this year. So what does the future hold for our favorite radioactive reptile? Partly inspired by the success of the Marvel Cinematic Universe and Legendary Pictures' Warner Brothers MonsterVerse, Toho revealed in 2018 that they are now at the planning stage for World of Godzilla, a future shared universe of their own where Godzilla and his kaiju buddies all get the chance to take the lead in their own films, and where Toho plans to have a variety of directors shed their own creative takes on the Godzilla universe while all taking place in the same continuity where we expect our favorite giant monsters to occasionally brawl it out Endgame style. There you have it, a full look at our King Kaiju's history from 1954 all the way to the far future of 2022. If anybody's got Kong's email, please forward this video, because I think poor Kong is going to need all the intel he can get. Not that it'll make a difference, huh?